About everything in the Qanimal kingdom. Let's meet tonight's menagerie, the questing Phill Jupitus. The queenly Cariad Lloyd. The quasi-autonomous Daliso Chaponda. And an absolute corker, Alan Davis. Tonight are a quartet of quadrupeds, a moose in a quarry. A moose in a quandary. A moose in a quadcopter. And a Komodo dragon in Quentin Tarantino's jacuzzi. Excellent. Right, I love this. What is blue and sounds like a whale?
Is it a blue whale?
And we're off for a roaring start. the whole...
Is it a sad dolphin? I didn't expect you to care. Of course, dolphins, we care about them.
Yeah, we care about them.
What does a whale sound like?
They're really soothing. You know, they have those tapes to help you get to sleep.
Yeah.
Steve, how far away are you? 1,500 miles. You meet me, yes. The sound is loud and clear. What are you eating? Plankton. You blue, you sound like a whale.
There was a genius comic called Linda Smith, and one of her best jokes was she said, I bought one of those tapes of whale music, and I thought it was really soothing. Turned out to be a dolphin tribute band.
So good.
Also, we don't know what it means. It could be soothing to us, but they're saying, I'm choking on the plastic.
Yes. I just remind everybody that this season is the letter Q.
Q, something. So Q. The Queen.
Something. What is blue and sounds like a whale?
A quail!
Yes, a blue quail is the correct answer.
We're doing Christmas cracker jokes.
We're just trying to upset
As
Alan.
In, what is orange and sounds like a parrot?
What is orange?
A carrot.
Sorry. So the blue quail lives in sub-Saharan Africa. Yeah. It's one of about 40 species of quail worldwide. Actually, only the males are blue. Gales, they're brown with buff underparts. Don't you love the word buff?
Yes.
Anybody know what the plural of quail is?
Quaili.
No, it's quail.
OK. It's just quail. It's always worth having a go, isn't it?
Yeah, isn't it?
Quail eye for the straight guy.
That's a programme I'd like to see. What did quail teach us about sex in space, do you suppose?
They sent quails up to space.
Yes, they could, in fact, be called the very first extraterrestrial life form.
OK, I'm going to take a mad guess.
Yep.
They taught us how to be caring lovers.
Well...
They sent the eggs up.
They did send the eggs up. They were the very first vertebrates to be born in space.
Zero gravity.
They went up into the Mir space station in 1990, part of the Russian program. They wanted to find out if quail would be a good food source for a long-term mission. So eight of them hatched out of that lot, but they couldn't cope with zero gravity. So they simply couldn't latch on and feed themselves at all. So this is the sweetest thing. The cosmonauts had to stop every 2 hours and feed the quail. And in the end, they invented a little jacket that harnessed them to the feeder. They were like that for feeding in the quail. what they discovered was it completely removes their sex drive.
What?
Yes, entirely going up into space. The female stopped ovulating, the males had reduced testosterone levels, and both sexes exhibited an absolute apathy to mating.
So this means my girlfriend's been to space.
Maybe.
I'd be all right if Sandra Bullock drifted by in her underwear. And I'd be... Oh, there's Sandra. I knew she'd be here.
Sorry, I'm having trouble concentrating. I'm just thinking about Sandra Bullock. But there seems to be a great deal of interest in the sex life of quails. So this is one of my favourite studies. So the University of Kentucky in 2011, they received a massive grant from the National Institute of Health to study what the effect of cocaine is on the sex drive of the Japanese quail.
Everyone's just deep-frying everything and see what happens.
Here's the thing that will surprise you. Apparently, the cocaine was linked to increased risky sexual behaviour.
Well, I'll say, where's my drugs?
So, old British words for quail, they used to be called butt for butt.
Butt for butt?
They get better. Wet my lips. And quick me dick.
And there's another medieval phrase for quail, which is cocaine whore.
They all refer to the sounds that they make. In fact, so does the word quail itself. It comes from the medieval Latin name for them, which was quacula. So it's supposed to be the sound. Shall we have a listen and see if we think it sounds like any of those things?
Got any gear? Got any gear?
You're going to love this, Alan. I have a fact that is just for you.
Okay.
The male Japanese quail, they have a gland above their sex organ. And
it's right up your alley.
It secretes a liquid containing... It has some of the same enzymes and proteins that you get in egg white. And they whip this into a stiff foam using their sphincter. And then... Yes, imagine you're beating like this.
I don't think I will. Quail meringue,
and
ever.
Then they deposit into the female after the sperm.
Like a dessert.
I don't know what it's
is it like clay to make sure it doesn't come back out?
Like a cork.
Yes.
Yes. There seems to be some advantage, but we don't know what it is, other than I think fun. We've talked a lot about the male quail. There's something interesting about the females. They're attracted to losers.
We've all been there. Yeah.
McMaster's University in Ontario, they did some research. So what they did, they had two male quail in a box with a plexiglass divider down the middle, and they fought by trying to peck each other through the glass. And they had a female quail watch this. And when she was placed in with the two males, she preferred the loser, the one who had shown the least aggression.
Perhaps it didn't show what he could do with his whipping sphincter. He lost the pecking, but she was checking the sphincter and she was like, look at the whip on that. Yes, please.
It's also possible she's hoping that the male quail is not going to be aggressive towards her.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Now, what's the most numerous undomesticated bird in the world?
Pigeon.
Oh, wait, that's what I was going to say.
Does that mean he's right?
No, he's wrong.
Oh, he's wrong.
It means he's wrong.
It means he's wrong, OK.
We'll hear that a lot when Alan speaks.
OK.
Chicken.
I told you. So, I'm going to give you a clue. This is one of the ways to kill it. This is a piece of dynamite.
OK.
The Roadrunner.
Woody Peck.
Yes!
Does it live in Britain?
No, so Daliso is in with the best chance of knowing this, as there are lots of these in Malawi.
OK.
Yes?
It's weaver birds. Quillia?
Quillia? Quillia.
Weaver bird is what we call
quillia.
Them.
Quillia. But quillia. Yes, you're absolutely right. It's called the red-billed quillia.
Oh,
yes. You should... What? They should not be applauding these things. They are a menace.
OK.
These things are like the bane of farmers. They, like, flock and they eat, like, everything.
Yeah, they're like... Feathered locusts.
That's exactly it, yes.
There are approximately 1.5 billion... of these birds. So to put that into some kind of context, the UK's most numerous bird is the wren. There are 8.6 million breeding pairs. They come in flocks of 2 million birds.
Oh, my God!
And each bird eats roughly half its own body weight a day.
What?
Are they going to eat that elephant?
Well, they're going to eat the the weight of an elephant, they can consume 20 tons a day, one flock. So they can absolutely decimate agriculture. It is an extraordinary thing.
And getting rid of them, they, like, people go through the field with, like, drums trying to chase them away. We don't have dynamite. That seems like a better plan than the drums.
The drums are like, we might get dynamite, guys. Yeah. We're seriously thinking about it.
We don't have the budget yet.
But you're right, if you don't have the money for dynamite, you just try and go into the field to scare them, but they're incredibly mobile and they'll just go on to the next field and...
They do have wings, don't they?
Yeah, I'm afraid so. But they've tried napalm, they've tried pathogens, they've tried electronic devices, dynamite, firebombing...
What about kindness? You know, a little bit of love. Full of Smarties and they all go over there.
No one thinks of it.
Or just a million cats.
Can you imagine the poor pilot who, you know, he wants to see action in the army and they send him to firebomb a bunch of birds?
Yeah, a bunch of birds. About 50 million are killed in South Africa alone every single year. But they have very few natural predators and the females produce about 9 offspring a year, so they're able to just keep replenishing themselves. I have to say, this is not the only animal that farmers use dynamite on. I love this story. In the Austrian province of Vorarlberg in 2018...
Oh, God.
They banned...
Not Daisy.
You're going to hate this. They banned the practice of blowing up dead cows.
Yeah. Is that how they'd make a stew? Why would...
So what it is that area, it's a very alpine area, it's right on the Swiss border, and when a cow dies, you've got to get rid of it, but it can die by falling down a precipice or being struck by lightning or something. But it's really difficult to get rid of the remains, and so they were having to helicopter the dead cows out. That costs $1,000 a trip, so some farmers were blowing them up. $32 to blow up.
There's no expense spared on it. Wow.
Yeah. Do you know why they've stopped doing it? It's against the law now to do it. Do you know why?
Well, it might spread diseases, surely.
Contamination of the groundwater. Yeah. But the other thing which I really like is it was putting tourists off.
What shall we do today? Yeah. Let's just blow it up. Yeah. I can't be asked getting a helicopter.
What fun.
What is happening over there in Austria? We're making some cheese with hogs in. We're hearing the banging and there is meat landing on my roof.
No, we're not. No, just carry on with your cheese. It's blowing up now!
I have a hoof in my cheese.
Don't tell everybody, they'll all want one.
Anyway, who's started waking up earlier in order to get more selfies?
Is it
teenagers?
Teenagers? No.
There are all these young pop stars, the Kardashians and stuff, who've got selfies. I get a buzz for saying Kim Kardashian?
Yeah, because we thought it was predictable that somebody at some point...
I'm not Kanye West!
Don't get cross, darling. It's fine. Remember, we're in Q and we're doing animals.
Q animals.
Q animals.
Quail.
Queen koala.
OK, you are in the right part of the world.
A queen kangaroo.
You are in the right part of the world. It is the world's...
Oh, that little, that tiny, the smiley face from New Zealand?
Yes. It's no, Australia.
Australia. Tiny, happy one from Australia. I mean, when you take a picture, it looks like he's smiling, and people keep taking pictures, and it looks like he's poking his head in, smiling. So
it
cute.
Is the world's happiest animal.
Is it a quagga?
Quagga. Yes, oh, absolutely so right. Very well. Have you seen one?
What?
Look. So cute.
No, I haven't. I want one.
They live mostly on a little tiny island called Rot Nest, just off Perth, just off the coast of Western Australia.
That's a great photo.
Isn't it the cutest
I don't
thing?
Trust it. That's like a person in a suit. That's...
Oh, look, have you seen the rest of the peloton? Oh, I lost the guys completely.
So the quokka is an Aboriginal word, and the Dutch sailors initially mistook them for giant rats, so that's why the island is called Rot Nest. And there are more than 7,400 quokka selfies, which were posted on social media in 2018.
Yeah, so cute.
Helped by the fact that people like Roger Federer, the tennis player, and Margot Robbie, the actress, both did them. There's Roger Federer with the quokka, and apparently...
Who are you R-ing, Roger Federer or the quokkas? Everybody was like,
Hello. were on push bikes as well.
Here is the sweetest thing about them. They're nocturnal, but those that are on Rottnest are now staying awake during the day in order to spend time with the tourists. And the ones who are on the bit of the island that's highly developed for tourism are doing better than the ones in the less disturbed habitats. Yeah. Here's the thing that's slightly going to put you off the clock.
Oh, oh. Does it shit in your face? Right,
it's got a gland that makes a stew that you have sex with.
Do not eat their pavlovas.
Not great parents. So when the female quokka becomes aware of a predator, the first thing she does is she ejects the joey from her pouch, and the infant lies on the ground making a sort of hissing noise, and this distraction allows the mother to escape and leave the predator.
I mean, you say bad parent, but in a way, she's smart, isn't she?
Animals do that, don't they?
Well, grey kangaroos do it, swamp wallabies, and there are lots of other
Are they called coquettes, the female quokkas?
Roger Federer and the Quokettes is the band I want to see.
Quokkas get their beauty sleep at night now, so they can always look their best for a daytime selfie.
But selfies are dangerous.
Oh, yes, they are. Many people die doing selfies.
Also, like, I was given advice by a comedian who said, oh, if a fan comes and they recognise you and they're excited, maybe you should say, oh, do you want a selfie? Because sometimes they're too shy. And I followed this advice.
Yes.
And in Nottingham, a woman was like, oh, I recognise you. I was like, oh, hi. And I said, do you want a selfie? And she said, no, you're not the Eiffel Tower.
Now, sticking with Australian marsupials, a quoll is a squirrel-sized marsupial, OK? Let us imagine that you're hosting a barbie, you're in Australia, and a mob of quolls turn up. What are you going to offer them?
Straight away, you give them a tinny. Then you ask them if they're vego.
OK. They're not vegetarian.
But why do we have to offer them anything? We didn't invite them. Now we're catering for everyone who turns up?
Yes, so there is a reason why you want them to eat something.
Because they're cuter than you.
So oh, no, no.
Eat it's... that which is cuter than you.
I don't think that's a nature's rule. What's a barbecue thing? Another barbecue thing?
Burgers, sausages.
Sausages! OK, sausages is what you need to offer them. Sausages. What kind of sausages do you think you might offer a quoll?
Vegetarian sausages.
OK, the reason we need to do this is to save them from extinction.
Oh,
is the real reason. Right,
they should have said that when they turned up.
Yeah, so...
we're being extinct, feed us. Because I was like, get out of here. This is my barbecue, but not my friends.
No, their numbers have dropped dramatically, and it is because partly they've been eaten by foxes and they've been eaten by cats, which were introduced by the Victorians, but also they like to eat cane toads. So, there is a toxin in the back of cane toad.
No.
So licking them can cause hallucinations, and there are indeed Australian dogs which are entirely addicted to doing this.
That's an addict.
A Labrador on a trip is a fantastic thought. But the quolls can be killed by this poison. So, in order to educate them not to eat cane toads, they're being fed sausages made from toad mince. They take the harmful skin off, and they make the mince, and they lace it with a chemical, which makes the quolls feel nauseous. The plan is to put them off eating toad.
But I think the ones in the wild don't smell like barbecued
toad. Also, were they hoping that they go back home? They're like, oh, Tiny, I had some toad. Yeah. No, I'm telling you what, it was bad. Oh, I'll go and tell Sheila. Let's spread the word. Well, Tiny had a bad toad sausage. We should all avoid it.
Up to 68% of the wild quolls that have been fed toad sausages have been put off eating toad.
They've got good social networking.
And they're actually hoping now that they can drop toad sausages by helicopter.
Could you just say that one more time.
They are astonishing cane toads, so they're not native to Australia at all. They're native to Central and South America. In 1935, they were brought in to sugar plantations in order to get rid of a pest, which was the cane beetle. They brought in 102 toads. It was a failure. Why?
Hello. I think we should definitely leave Europe.
Why would it be a failure?
They eat other things.
No, so they live on the ground and beetles can fly.
Oh, shit.
Duh. The These 102 toads have grown into today's population of 1.5 billion toads.
God.
And they have devastated Australia's flora and
fauna. Toads love to do it.
Oh, a female toad can have 35,000 eggs.
What?
Yeah. So here's a nice thing, apart from the toad sausages. One of the ways they're thinking now of saving the quoll is to turn them into pets. There are people who say that you should have them instead of a cat. And, in fact, they're rather sweet. They can be trained. They can use a litter tray. They weigh about the same.
Sweet. Really sweet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Working out?
Have you got your foot sticking out from under the duvet and that gets hold of you?
They do have the second biggest bite force quotient. So how hard they can bite relative to the size of any animal.
Good for children, then.
Yeah. Second only to the Tasmanian devil.
Oh, my God.
But, of course, keeping them as pets is not going to save the wild population in any way whatsoever. Here's a fact about quolls that I love. The breeding season only lasts for 3 days, during which they mate with their partner every 15 minutes for the entire duration.
Oh, wow. Of the 3 days.
Yeah. The males and the females only meet for that 3-day fest.
They want to stop eating the toads and talk to them about having sex.
Yeah. Also, not great parents, these ones.
Yeah, oh, they're not
great parents. Here we go.
No, so what they do is they give birth to about 30 offspring. Each one is the size of a grain of rice. But the female qual only has 6 nipples, so the first 6 who are fastest latch on.
Come on, boys! Yeah. Which rice is fastest?
Yeah.
Like some insane reality show.
Why don't you just sit like that in your living room?
The idea of you being a squirrel-sized marsupial.
Why, a tremendous bite force! Well, that's equivalent to the Tasmanian devil, which can have sex whenever it wants!
Scientists are encouraging quolls to eat sausages rather than toads in the hole. Right, moving on. What is wrong with this zebra?
Ooh.
Yes.
No barcode.
It's just like a mutant zebra with, like, half the stripes.
It's an extinct subspecies
of
zebra.
Oh, someone shouted
zebra.
Out.
It's a... It is a quagga, indeed.
But wait, didn't we already... Aren't the birds the quaggas?
Quaggas and quackers.
No, so we've had quolls and quackers and quillea. It's Q, darling. There's going to be a lot of animals beginning with Q.
It just feels like Dr. Zeus has moved in and started taking over. It's quackers and quaggas and quails.
And all of them have the most magnificent tails.
It's an extinct subspecies of zebra, lived in southern Africa. It was stripy, but only down to the shoulders. It's been sort of described as a zebra who's forgotten his pyjama bottoms.
I'll tell you an interesting thing about stripes. I went to school in Kenya, and we read early colonial books, and they theorised, because they'd never seen any mixed-race children, so they imagined that a child would be born with stripes if a black person and a white person...
Are you kidding?
Yeah, no, it makes sense if you think about it. If you've never... seen it, it's more logical, you know. These are people who thought the world was flat, okay? But still, you know, that's what they thought would happen.
That's appalling.
It's appalling.
Can I just apologize?
It's nice saying, but it's a bit like.
Anyway, what I love about the quagga is it's a really good example of humans sorting out the natural world. The quagga was made a protected species 3 years after it had already become extinct. And I was given legal protection by the Cape Town government in 1886, and the last one died in an Amsterdam zoo in 1883. So they were 3 years too late.
Wake up, Clifford, it is time for your Edam. No, he's dead.
No, Dutch zookeeper.
Yeah, no, fair enough.
I thought it'd be called Clifford.
They have tried to reverse engineer a quagga. So in 1987, they tried to see if they could get one through selective breeding. And in fact, they successfully bred the plain hindquarters, but it is still genetically a zebra. It is
Did not anybody not watch Jurassic Park?
Here's an interesting thing. For a long time, Grant Museum at the University College London believed it owned 2 zebra skeletons. But they re-examined them in 1972. They found one was a quagga, and one was a donkey, so they didn't have any zebra skeletons. this is a fantastic thing. This is the actual skeleton of the quagga. Now, if you have a look at the back left leg, you can see that there is just a sort of a black outline, and that is because that particular leg is missing on this quagga. And this has an extraordinary story, and here to tell us about it is the curator of the Grant Museum, Tanis Davidson. Oh. Hello, Tanis. Say, fabulous museum, and a rare museum, is it not, the Grant Museum?
Yes, we are the last university zoological museum in London.
And anybody can go and visit it?
Yes, we're open to the public Monday through Saturday, 1 till 5.
OK, so these skeletons of quaggas, how many do you think there are in the world?
Well, it's one of our star specimens. We think there's only 7 quagga skeletons anywhere in the world.
Right.
And as far as I know, ours is the only one with a skull.
But it's missing a leg. What happened? Where the hell is the leg?
Well, the first idea is that it had been loaned to the Royal College of Surgeons just
right.
before World War II. And of course that building was bombed, so it was lost during the bombing. Another idea was that when the specimens were evacuated to Wales, it somehow became lost.
So it could still be in Wales?
It could be.
OK, and you're holding a thing here now that this is
yes,
what it would look like.
This is what it looks like.
Right. How would you know the difference between a quagga leg and a zebra leg?
It's very difficult.
Oh. So if you've got one, you may think that it is in fact a zebra leg?
Yes, there is an idea that perhaps this might be in someone's collection if it was lost in Wales and maybe somebody thought it was a donkey leg or
right.
a horse leg. So...
But you could compare it to your actual skeleton and see if it is a
yes,
match.
If somebody found something like this,
yes.
we could, you know, slot it in perfectly and it would just all become
okay.
you know, a whole specimen again.
I feel we are the show to help you with this.
Okay.
So, this is a Crime Watch appeal. Any information relating to the whereabouts of this missing quagga leg, please, please contact me. There is a reward, an all expenses paid trip to the mountains of Kong. Thank you. Thank you very much, Tanis. Fantastic. I love the idea. Somebody in Wales is going, I think there's one of those in
I
the
know,
loft.
I know.
Anyway, what is the most offensive thing anyone could do with this? I actually have two, and it involves doing something with two of them.
Sandy. Yeah. Sandy, for me. For me. Come on, both of them.
This summer, from okay. Walt Disney Productions.
So, if you need both of them, you actually have to hold them like this.
Well, like boxing gloves.
It is exactly that, that they were used as boxing
oh.
gloves.
So, no!
I know. So, this is a queen conch, actually, in the United States. It's called a conch, but the British say a conch. So, about 3,000 years ago, the Mayans used them as boxing gloves, or more of a knuckle duster, yeah. possibly, part of the ritual worship of the rain god Charlock. And, honestly... It resulted in quite a lot of bloodletting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which was apparently part of the ceremony. I don't know what they put on their heads. That is this.
I would imagine if you're in a culture that's hitting each other wearing conches as boxing gloves, you're going to invent the crash helmet really fast.
Yeah. It is an extraordinary thing, the queen conch. Large species of sea snail. It lives in the Atlantic. It's incredibly strong, 10 times stronger than mother of pearl. So very few predators can get into this shell, except the nurse shark. And what it does is it doesn't actually crack the shell, it just sucks the conch.
Oh, no. What a way to go.
I know.
Sucked off by a shark.
That's the best production of West Side Story I ever saw.
Phil, conch yeah. shell playing also has a tremendous tradition. So I have put a conch beside you. There's a tiny bit kind of cut off.
Whoa.
And the Aztecs used to have a conch shell trumpet. It was called a quiquizli. And the musicians who played them were called Quiquizoini, and it's thought to have had the power to defeat the Aztec Lord of the Dead. Are you ready? Noise.
That's
apparently,
amazing.
If you move your hand in and out of the aperture, that is
oh.
the way in which you get.
Look, Bill. Shut up, it's
no.
jazz.
We're there's an annual conch blowing competition held in Key West, Florida.
I bet there is.
In 2018, a 70-year-old woman called Mary Lou Smith, she won the woman's division, and her fellow conch player, a man called Rick Race, dropped to one knee and proposed.
Aww.
I know. It's a thing. People in Key West and in the Bahamas, they call themselves conches.
What am I supposed to do with mine?
I don't know. That looks like some sort of Star Wars character.
I have not seen Solo.
I am your father. Oh, you will come to the seaside with me, darling. I will buy you some chips and we will go for a walk.
I can't get it off, Sandy. I can't get it off.
I'm OK with that.
Oh, what a way to finish your career.
Anyway, what does it mean if Quentin the Quahog squirts to the right?
Ooh.
Ooh.
He votes Tory.
No, it's spelled like this. Have a look at this and see if this...
It's a shellfish, isn't it? It's a clam. Like a clam.
So where would you... Have you seen that before?
They're in New England.
They are, but where else might you have seen Quahog?
It's a... Oh, it's Family Guy.
Yeah, so it's set in a fictitious town, Family Guy, of Quahog.
Oh, yeah.
Rhode Island, and February the 2nd in the United States is Groundhog Day, most of North America, but in Nantucket, it is Quahog Day. And a quahog called Quentin is opened, and the direction that the water spurts from his shell predicts whether winter is over. So if it squirts to the left, 6 more weeks of winter. If it squirts to the right...
That should come with a trigger warning. That. I was not
If it squirts to the right, then winter is over. Unfortunately, Quentin himself does not live to see the prediction come true because he's eaten immediately by the harbour master. That's the ceremony.
Oh,
so there's a new Quentin every year. Have you seen the Groundhog when they do the Groundhog Day thing?
Yeah.
So that's Punxsutawney Phil, that's the name of the groundhog in
Bumps. Did you see on one of the movie channels the other day when it was actually Groundhog Day? They ran Groundhog Day all day.
Oh. They've been doing it since 1887. I mean, Quahog Day's only been going for 10 years, but the groundhog thing is hugely old. Although quahogs are very old in themselves. So in 2006, there were some researchers from Bangor University, and they opened up the shell of an ocean quahog, which they dredged from the coast of Iceland. Unfortunately, they had just killed the oldest animal known to science. It was 507 years old.
Oh, you know, humans.
Yeah. They were very upset. Paul Butler from the university said, we had no idea it was that old before it was too late.
That would be a good section to do on the show, when scientists are sometimes dicks.
there once was a clam from Nantucket. I'll let you finish that one in your own time. Now, who would want to kiss these lips?
Oh, go on, then.
Another one of those would want to kiss them.
It's a freshwater fish found throughout North America. It's called a quillback sucker.
Oh!
So, they've got these really thick, fleshy lips and it allows their mouths to act like a vacuum. They can actually attach to surfaces by suction. But here is how nature can be a, you know, rotter. They have a really tiny esophagus. So they've got this great, big, fantastic vacuum mouth, but they can only eat microscopic things like algae. I know. It just seems mean, doesn't it? Big mouth, tiny ability to swallow.
But...
We don't have to follow through.
I don't know what you're saying. So the oldest recorded quillback, 95 years old.
What?
It doesn't actually have quills on its back. That's it's a bit of a misnomer. It's that its dorsal fin is shaped a bit like a quill pen, is the reason. They have a polygynandrous mating system. What that means is two or more males will mate exclusively with two or more females. It's like they belong to a swingers club.
The dirty bastards.
Yeah. Yeah. There is a quillback rockfish.
I bet there is.
And that has sharp venomous spines on its dorsal fin, and that protects it.
Ooh, there he is.
That's not nice.
Your name's not Dan, you're not coming in.
So, most well-known quilled animal is?
The porcupine.
Porcupine. How does a porcupine make love?
Carefully.
OK, two families of porcupines, there's Old World and New World. This thing that we're looking here, North American New World porcupine. So, sex takes about a minute, all right? And the female signals her interest by urinating and screaming. We've all been there.
We've all been there.
to alarm anybody. We're just about to have a look at porcupines.
Is it horizontal?
Well, I'm going to show you.
Oh. So, time to.
Here's the thing. So. Mating is.
Yes, carry on. Go on. Good.
Mating is spike free.
Yeah.
So what happens is the female turns her back on the male. She arches her tail over her back. That's covering her quills and cushioning them.
Let's talk quick. More about what?
So there she's pushing.
Let's get it on. Let's get it on.
But his member has got bristly barbs on the tip. And it usually points backwards in its sheath, but it's more like a sort of flick knife. It comes up like a sort of a... That's all I can say. Female looks like this when they're finished. There we are, yeah.
Just put it under a hand dryer.
Here's a cute thing. Baby porcupines are called porcupettes. I know. Oh, that's so
cute. You can't do 5 minutes of something filth and then do cute baby names.
It's time to move us along. What would a porcupine make of this?
Nice place to have sex. Seems to be what we know about them.
You're not far off. So American porcupines are extremely good at climbing trees, and it is one of the ways in which a female might show her interest is to climb a tree. And then urinate and scream.
I've climbed a tree!
Lots of them spend their entire lives up a tree, and as a consequence, I love this, they make their own antibiotics in their quills.
What?
Because they keep falling out of the tree and impaling themselves on the quills. I mean, that's quite flexible and bend as the porcupine lands, but they really razor sharp, the quills. They can penetrate skin unbelievably easily. But they're extremely painful to extract because they have backwards-pointing barbs. So scientists are now trying to mimic this exact mechanism so we could develop better medical adhesives, so things like nicotine patches. You don't like it, you don't like to look
at it. No, it's a bit much, isn't
it? Okay.
Can we have them having sex again, please?
Now, that brings us to the loving and soft environment that we call general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. According to the traditional proverb, what killed the cat?
Oh, my God!
Yes!
Curiosity.
The original version for over 260 years was that care killed the cat. Care meaning worry or sorrow. If you know your Shakespeare, it's in Much Ado. What courage, man! What though care killed a cat, thou hast metal enough in thee to kill care. In the mid-19th century, care was replaced by curiosity, and we just don't,
know
why. The Russian version of this phrase is curious Barbara's nose was torn off at the market. Which I'm going to use in the future. I think it's rather better than curiosity killed the cat. Actually, cats are in lots of phrases, aren't they? The cat got the canary, cat got the cream.
Cat got the cream, yeah.
Cat's away, the mice will play. Cat's got your tongue. Anybody know why cat's got your tongue?
Because they're bastards.
Is that about the cat of nine tails?
It may be that. It could be as far back as, you know, the Middle East from about 500 BC. Apparently, liars had their tongues removed and fed to cats as a punishment.
Oh. If you die...
Yeah?
..and you've got cats and no-one finds you, after about 3 days, they will feed on your face.
Look at them. Those six there, that's what they're going to do.
I am firm in my belief that that is true, because when Thomas Hardy died, the nation wanted him to be buried in Poets' Corner in Westminster Abbey, but his wife wanted him to be buried in Dorset. So it was arranged that his heart would be removed after his death and the body would go to Poets' Corner and the heart would be buried in Dorset. Anyway, the surgeon came, did it at the house. They weren't doing the burial of the heart till the next day, so he put it in a biscuit tin in the larder. And apparently, in the morning, the cat had managed to open the biscuit... Yes. Anyway, the cat eventually died. They buried the cat.
Up to its neck.
Yeah. But cats only eat their dead owners if they can't get out.
Yeah, oh, yeah, they don't want to, but they're hungry.
No. Yeah. If you're going to die, leave the cat flap open.
Yeah, put on a fencing mask. He's going.
He's put a bastard mask on.
Bastard!
Curiously, it was care that killed the cat. How can you tell if a bird is a songbird?
It will be singing.
it's got a record deal and it's on Spotify.
It's in Little Mix.
So here's the thing, not all songbirds sing. A songbird is defined as any bird that belongs to the passerine suborder. So Basically,
Cilla Black. She was a songbird.
She was a songbird. You need to have three toes facing forward and one facing back, so they're perching.
Cilla Black. What's it all about, Alfie?
The syrinx is the name for their songbox, and some are so developed that they can sing two notes at once really, really fast. There is a bird called the Northern Cardinal. It is able to sing more notes than is on the piano keyboard in a tenth of a second. Mm. I know, that is really astonishing. But the definition of songbird is not about whether the birds actually sing, because, in fact, females, 29% of songbird species don't sing at all. So, according to the RSPB, birdsong is any sound used to attract a mate or to protect territory.
OK.
Birdsong isn't just for songbirds. How would this animal protect itself?
By, oh, roll, rolling into a ball.
Would it just lie down?
So, here's the thing. There are 18 species of armadillo. Only two of them, the Brazilian three-banded and the southern three-banded, roll up into a ball. I was showing you a six-banded armadillo, which does not do that.
It rolls into a square.
No, it does not go into a square, no.
That is the Rubik's armadillo. Yeah.
You were right, Alan. They very quickly dig a hole and get into it and just line it with only the armour showing.
Is he trying to get in that hole?
Well, he's trying to dig it.
But there's one already in there. Get your own hole.
But they have another marvellous way of escaping a predator. So the nine-banded armadillo can walk underwater.
What?
So it can hold its breath for as long as 6 minutes getting under the water.
What?
It can also make itself buoyant on the water by swallowing air and inflating its stomach and intestines.
It's Jesus.
It is a fantastic thing. Other facts about armadillos. What disease are they thought to be the only ones to get?
Leprosy. 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 Oh, that was you. It wasn't us. You lost points on that. It's not so easy, is it? It's hard.
They can get leprosy, but so can mice and rats. And in fact, a 2016 study found that one-third of red squirrels in Britain carry leprosy.
Oh, where's your tail? It's the most appealing thing about me. Now I'm just a hamster.
Right, this is true. I have terrible asthma. I do. Which of these dogs should I buy?
Toad-licking Labrador.
We're obsessed with the hallucinating dog.
You've got to get a toad-licking psychedelic Labrador.
So is it going to be not a hypoallergenic dog, oddly?
Well, oddly, there's no such thing, really. So there are all sorts of dogs that are described as hypoallergenic. There's no evidence to support that there's such a thing.
No, but I'm allergic to... And the wirier dogs that shed more, you tend to have more reactions.
It's the dog's saliva and it's the dog's dander or the flakes of dead skin. It is found in all dog breeds. There is some thought that if they shed less fur, they release less of this protein into the environment and so into the nostrils of sufferers.
Yeah.
I have to say it's not been proved. But to be clear about this, there's no evidence to support the idea of a totally hyperallergenic dog. There are dogs that perhaps might make your life a little...
Yeah, they make it a bit easier. I'd be fine with a cockapoo.
If you're allergic to dogs, get a budgie. But now, the issue that's been dogging us, the score.
Oh, really?
The top dog with minus five is Daliso! And second place with minus six, it's Phill! Actually, we're tied, you and Cariad, also minus six, so you're minus six. With minus 10, it's the audience! Alan, you've outdone yourself in final place with minus 56. Alan! So, it's thanks to Daliso, Phill, Cariad and Alan, and I leave you with this quick quotation from the Porcupine poem by Ogden Nash. Any hound a porcupine nudges can't be blamed for harbouring grudges. I know one hound that laughed all winter at a porcupine that sat on a splinter. Thank you, good night.